Good morning.
Yep.
Tis good to see y'all here. Let's spend just a moment or two quieting our hearts and minds, shutting out the noise of the world, and prepare ourselves to worship the Lord. Turning to number 660 in your blue hymnal, let us stand. Begins on page 355 in the Red Book of Common Prayer, page 355. Yep, that's the right page. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Page 356, the Gloria, together.
Glory to God in the highest. And peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most.
have mercy.
Lord, have mercy. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Let us pray. Grant, O merciful Lord, that your church, being gathered together in unity by your Holy Spirit, may show forth your power among all peoples to the glory of your name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated and attentive to the reading of God's word.
Our first lesson comes from the 1 Kings chapter 11, starting with verse 22. The reading can be found in your online bulletin, your personal Bibles, and on page 272 of your pew Bible. A reading from 1 Kings. Then Solomon stood before the altar of the Lord in the presence of all the assembly of Israel and spread out his hands to heaven. He said, O Lord, God of Israel, there is no God like you in heaven, above, or on earth beneath, keeping covenant and steadfast love for your servants who walk before you with all their heart, the covenant that you kept for your servant, my father David, as you declared to him, you promised with your mouth and have this day fulfilled with your hand. Therefore, O Lord, God of Israel, keep for your servant, my father David, that which you promised him, saying, there shall never fail you a successor before me to sit on the throne of Israel. If only your children look to their way to walk before me as you have walked before me. Therefore, O God of Israel, let your word be confirmed, which you promised to your servant, my father David. But will God indeed dwell on the earth? Even heaven and the highest heaven cannot contain you, much less this house that I have built. Have regard to your servant's prayer and his plea, O Lord my God, heeding the cry and the prayer that your servant prays to you today, that your eyes may be open night and day towards this house, the place of which you said, my name shall be there, that you may heed the prayer that your servant prays towards this place. Hear the plea of your servant and of your people Israel when they pray towards this place. O, hear in heaven your dwelling place, heed and forgive. Likewise, when a foreigner who is not of your people Israel comes from a distant land because of your name, for they shall hear of your great name, your mighty hand, and your outstretched arm. When a foreigner comes and prays towards this house, then hear in heaven your dwelling place and do according to all that the foreigner calls to you, so that all the peoples of the earth may know your name and fear you, as do your people Israel, and so that they may know that your name has been invoked on this house that I have built. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 84. The psalm can be found on page 707 in the Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray Psalm 84 responsively by whole verse. I will begin. How dear to me is your dwelling, O Lord of hosts. My soul has a desire and longing for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh rejoice in the living God.
The sparrow has been on her house,
and the swallow the nest where she may lay her young. By the side of your altars, O Lord of hosts, my King and my God.
Happy are they who dwell in your house. They will always be praising you.
Happy are the people whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on a pilgrim's way.
Those who go through the desolate valley will find it a place of springs, for the early rains have covered it with pools of water.
They will climb from height to height, and the God of gods will reveal himself inside.
Lord God of hosts, hear my prayer. Hearken, O God of Jacob.
Behold our defender, O God, and look upon the face of your anointed.
For one day in your courts is better than 1,000 in my own room, and to stand at the threshold of the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked.
For the Lord God is both sun and shield. He will give grace to the Lord.
No good thing will the Lord withhold from those who walk with integrity.
O Lord of hosts, happy are they who put their trust in you.
Our second lesson comes from the letter to the church in Ephesus, chapter 6, verses 10 to 20. The reading can be found in our online bulletin, your personal Bibles, and on page 952 of your pew Bible. A reading from Ephesians. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand, therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times and in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father. So whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and they died. But the one who eats this bread will live forever. He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue in Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life. The flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones who did not believe and who was the one who would betray him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please pray with and for me. In words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts, be acceptable to you, our Lord and our God. Father God, may only your words be spoken and your words heard. And this we pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please let me be seated. Now, I'm going to start off making an assumption that everybody in this room at least one point in time has been offended. Yep. Somebody has said something or done something that got underneath your skin and you took it personally. They said a word. They accused you of something. They called you a name. They gestured something in your general direction. And you were offended by it. And that makes us human. To be offended means that something has impacted you in a negative way. And we often like to resist being offended. In this day and age, being offended comes relatively easy. We're living in a day and age where we have to be exceedingly careful about what we say and who we say it to. Even on our college campuses, there are now safe spaces where you know that you can go to and sit in quiet and that nobody can utter a word to you lest you be offended. Most of us would like to think that our Lord and Savior Jesus was a person who would approve of these kinds of actions where nobody's feelers get hurt, nobody gets upset by anything that is said, that it's always peace and love and joy and harmony, that we're all just having one happy love and peace in. Yeah, not so much. Doesn't take much reading the scripture to realize that although Jesus was about peace and loving your neighbor and loving God, he did offend some folks from time to time. And we often gloss over those sections of scripture because we don't want to have our image of Jesus being confused and changed from the old happy, peace-loving, hippie kind of Jesus to one who really just got some folks upset. For example, in Matthew 17, don't have to look it up because I got it here for you. When they came with the crowd, a man came and knelt before him and said, "Lord, have mercy on my son, for he's an epileptic and he suffers terribly. He often falls into the fire and into the water. I brought him to your disciples, but they could not cure him." And Jesus answered, "You faithless and perverse generation, how much longer must I be with you?" Ouch! I don't know about you, but if I'd been one of the group that had been following him along and doing everything that he said and being compelled to do what he had been teaching to be called faithless and perverse, I mean, that's got to be pretty offensive. And now to add insult to injury, bring him here to me. And Jesus rebuked the demon and it came out of him and the boy was cured instantly. Not only am I going to insult you, but I'm going to do what you cannot. The disciples came to him privately because they had already been publicly rebuked. And they said, "Why could we not cast him out?" And here's where it really gets pointed. A little salt into the wound when he says, "Because of your little faith." First your faith was, then your perverse, and now you ain't got any faith at all. And he describes it, if you had the faith of a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, "Move from here to there," and it would be moved. If you had just the smallest modicum of faith, that of a mustard seed, something really so small it's hardly seen, if you'd had that much faith, you'd have been able to tell that demon, but you did not. I can imagine that probably stung and may have offended some of his disciples. And these were his friends that he's talking to here. Now, lest you think that Jesus was only this way towards his disciples, if we read in Matthew 21 and in John 2, it says, Jesus entered the temple, because he did that a couple of times in his ministry, twice in John and once in Matthew. Jesus entered into the temple, and he drove out all who were selling and buying in the temple. He overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. He made a whip out of cords, and he was beating people left, right, and center. "Get out of my father's house." "Well, wait a minute. We have a right to be here. Who are you? How dare you do this? This is my father's house, and you have changed it into a den of thieves." Insulting absolutely everybody who'd been in that outer court. You cannot tell me there were some folks there who were offended. Their livelihood had been upset. The business that they were doing, trying to help people in the temple, he just called them all thieves. Do you think they were just a little offended? I'm thinking so. And then Jesus gets personal. So he's taking this out on his disciples, he's taking it out on the general public, and now he's going to go after yet his own family. Mark chapter 3. And his mother and his brothers came, and they were standing outside where he was in eating. And they sent to him and called him. The crowd sitting around him, and they said, "Your mother and your brother and your sisters and your brother, your mother and your brothers and your sisters are outside asking for you." "Son, it's your mom. Can we come in?" "Jesus, this is your mother speaking."
Let us in.
Yo, bro, what's happening? We're outside, right? Mother and brother. Oh, brother and sisters, just in case there was some doubt in your mind, the ever virgin Mary was not ever a virgin. Okay, she only had one immaculate conception. Brothers and sisters indicated that she did have other children. Just in case you were wondering, if Jesus had brothers and sisters, his brothers and sisters were outside. Although they probably didn't necessarily want to be in that company right now, because he says, who are my mother and my brothers and my sisters? And he looked at those who sat around him and said, here is my mother, here is my brothers, here is my sisters. These people sitting around the table, not necessarily the people sitting outside calling for me. Whoever does the will of God is my brother, my sister, and my mother. Wait a minute. Flesh and blood, he has just discounted all of his family. If I were a Jewish mom back in that day, I think I'd have been offended. I don't think I'd have taken off a sandal and thrown it at the boy through the window. Had it swirl around five different rooms before it popped him upside the head. Pretty offensive to yet even his own family. Now, Jesus said these things to cut through to the heart of his teachings. He said these things because if you take it personally, then he's trying to get your undivided attention. Because there is a deeper message in what Jesus is trying to tell us. In our reading today, Jesus seriously is upsetting folks. We've been talking in John the last couple weeks about Jesus being the bread of life. And that you have to eat the bread and drink his blood if you want to have life in him. I am the bread of life. He says it over and over and over. What does this mean that I am the bread of life? Whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like the bread that your ancestors ate and died, but whoever eats of this bread will live. Now, understand that cannibalism was frowned upon back in the Jewish day. Right? Cannibalism is frowned on in this day. Not unlike the series Jane and I have been watching called iZombie, where you have to eat brains to survive and live. Now, we're not talking about that. It's a pretty good series.
No, it's not.
Which is the reason why we binge watch it all the time. Because it's horrible, isn't it? He's talking about something else, though. When his disciples heard this, they said, this teaching is difficult. Who can accept it? Who can understand what they mean with eating this bread? What do you want us to do? Cut you up and gnaw on you? What are we going to do? Hang you upside down, drain your blood, and drink it? This is difficult. What do you mean? Who can accept this? I am the bread. You have to eat this bread. Jesus hears them complaining and says, does this offend you? Do you not understand what I am saying? You are thinking eating of the flesh, but I am here to tell you this flesh is useless. This flesh is not what it's all about. What I'm giving you is the spirit of truth. What I'm giving you are words that you can eat and make a part of you that you can use to live forever.
And if that's upsetting, to complete the picture, then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? Jesus had told him a couple of chapters earlier that he was going to die. And that offended them to the point where they took him aside and rebuked him. Said, no, Jesus, you can't do that. Not realizing that unless he dies, unless he is put up on that cross, unless he's put into that tomb, unless he hangs out in there for 3 days, he cannot rise again, conquering death, taking the penalty for all our sins. That's offensive in ways even today. One of the complaints that we have about the church and people talk about Christians and talk about Jesus in particular is, I don't need anybody to die for me. I haven't done anything so wrong. If you say that Jesus had to die for me, that's offensive, because what you're telling me is that I have done something worthy of death, and I have done nothing like that. I've been a good person. I don't steal too much. I don't lie too much. I don't break most of the Ten Commandments. I have done nothing to have Jesus die for me. You have offended me down to my core. You are telling me that I'm a bad person. Tell me if you've stolen anything in your life, taken something that did not belong to you, walked off with a pin from the bank, from the church. From where? Right? Seen a pair of sunglasses laying on the table at the end of a meeting and everybody's gone, and you light them sunglasses and you put them in your pocket and you walked off. I've never done that. You've stolen anything that makes you a thief. Ever tell an untruth? Stretched it maybe a little bit? Didn't say something that you were supposed to say? That makes you a liar. Ever looked at somebody and went, when your partner's sitting right next to you? And although it didn't go much past the some of you went like, boy, that was back in the day, I'd have, That makes you an adulterer. So you are lying, thieving, adulterer, and you call yourself a good person. Does that offend you? We all needed Jesus to come and die for us. We all needed Jesus to do for us what we could not do. And because of that, some of us are likely to turn our backs on Jesus, because we don't want to hear this offensive word. We don't want to have these truths tossed back in our face. We don't want to realize that we are the ones that put him up on the cross that he died for. He died for us. We don't want to feel that way. And so we may want to turn our backs, as many of his disciples did. We say many of his disciples, remember that earlier on, he sent out 72, two by two. This is a large group of people who had been hanging around Jesus, who had gone out to do his will. But he knew some of these people were fair-weather disciples. When the going get tough, the tough get going away. Some of them left. And he was like, bye-bye, see you later. Notice, he
doesn't go running after them. Oh, please, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to offend you. Please come back. I'm going to tone it down a little bit. I'll be a nicer, kinder Jesus. He did not do that. He turned to the 12 who were standing around him going, That's tough. In the synagogue, he's teaching. And he says, do you wish to go away too? Are you going to follow the herd? Is this going to be a mass exodus like lemmings falling into the sea? Simon Peter, my hero, answered him, Lord, to whom can we go? You and you alone have the words of life. We've come to know through the word of God. We've come to believe that you are the Christ, and we're going to follow wherever you lead. We have that same question put before us each and every day. Are you going to stand and believe, or are we going to turn our back? Do we recognize who Jesus is and what he did for us and for everyone, and are we going to stand firm in that, or are we going to turn and walk away? It is a daily question, particularly in this world who does not want to believe that Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. When we confess that, when we proclaim that, we offend a great number of people who are believing there are great numbers of ways of being able to get into heaven. And I'm here to tell you, there's going to be a lot of surprised people when they walk up to the gate. Because they refuse to believe and hear and understand. I am the way, says Jesus. I am the life, says Jesus. I am the truth. The only way we can make that stand is if we do what Paul tells the church in Ephesus to do, to put on that full armor of God. Now, putting on that full armor of God is another sermon which would take me another 45 minutes, and I know y'all ain't got the time or the energy to hear that. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. That's the more talk.
If I'd had another cup of coffee, you'd be getting to that sermon right now, but I only had two. So I leave you with this. Remember what Peter said. Take it in your heart. Believe it, know it, practice it, preach it, pray for it. Lord, to whom can we go? Who can we turn to? The words of eternal life. And the basic instructions before leaving earth. You, Lord Jesus, are the Holy One of God. And for what you have done for us, we are eternally grateful. And we thank you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
turning to page 358 in the Red Book of Common Prayer, page 358. But let us stand and affirm what we know to be true as expressed for us in the ancient words of the Nicene Creed. When I ask you, my brothers and sisters, what do you believe? Together,
we believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Kneeling, let us pray for the whole state of Christ's church and the world.
Of the people for the days after Pentecost are Form 5 and start on page 389 of the Book of Common Prayer. In peace. Let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love, and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Sean, our presiding bishop-elect, Michael, our bishop, Daniel and Scott, the priests, and for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth. Today we pray especially for Borderland Deanery. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who do not yet believe, and for those who have lost their faith, that they may receive the light of the gospel, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those in positions of public trust, especially Joe, our president, and Michelle and Greg, our governor, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who live and work in this community, we pray, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For a blessing upon all human labor, and for the right use of the riches of creation, that the world may be freed from poverty, famine, and disaster, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, today we pray especially for Stephanie, Kim, Laura, Megan, the Roberts family, Leo, Seth, Kevin, Judy M., Ricky, Justin, Charles, Aaron, Marion, Mark, Deandra, Maricela, Hal, Viva, Maria, Tom, Patty, Danny J., Fugo, Andrew, Keenan, Colonel Michael, Anna, Elsa, Jerry, Christina, my sister Stella. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this congregation, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O God, Heavenly Father, who by your Son Jesus Christ has promised to all those who seek your kingdom and its righteousness all things necessary to sustain their life, send us, we entreat you, this time of need, such moderate rain and showers, that we may receive the fruits of the earth to our comfort and to your honor. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our enemies and those who wish us harm, and for all whom we have injured or offended, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, we pray for the repose of the soul of Fletcher Dearman, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints, they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Please add your own intercessions and thanksgiving at this time, either silently or aloud.
Heavenly Father, I thank you for this upcoming time of rest and relaxation for Daniel and I. I pray, Father, that your Holy Spirit would follow us and that your angels would protect us.
Lord, I pray for Cindy as she's entering into a time of transition. We pray that you would make that smooth and peaceful, that when she sees your hand, Lord Jesus, that she takes it and walks through the door that leads to eternal life. We pray for those in the congregation who are dealing with various illnesses, cancers, and infirmities. Pray for the Gardner family. Pray for all of those parents who've taken kids and dropped them off at college, that they both rejoice and grieve these changes.
I thank you, Father, for giving me more than I deserve.
Amen.
Rejoicing. In the fellowship of St. Luke and all the saints, Let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God.
To you, O Lord our God.
Almighty and eternal God, ruler of all things in heaven and earth, mercifully accept the prayers of your people and strengthen us to do your will through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. On page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Let's spend a moment or two allowing the Holy Spirit to reveal to us those things which we need to confess privately before we continue with our public corporate confession. On page 360, together, most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Please stand. My brothers and sisters, the peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
Please share that peace with those closest to you.
Oh my God, I love that book.
Alright, enough of this piece. Have a seat. First of all, a good thanks to everybody who's signed up for the country fair. We've got several names on here. We've got several more slots. So if you haven't signed up, please do so. The more help we have, the better. Speaking of the country fair, we have a design for this year's shirt that is just hilarious. The saying on it, I am positive, will bring a smile to the face of those people who read it, because it says, let's party, P-A-W-T-Y, and let's live like someone left the gate open. For those of you who have dogs, that you know what happens when you leave open the gate and they are gone. That sounds like most dachshunds that I know of. So let's live like that. Let's potty for our 40th anniversary. We have pre-order forms which are in the narthex. Please put your name on the form, put on your size that you want, and make payments to St. Luke's. This form we would really like to have back here in our hot little hands pre-order by Sunday, September 15th, okay? And it says that on the form just in case you're wondering what time you need to have it in by. Use the form, if you've written a check, put the form attached to the check and put it either in the little donation box, which is in the narthex, or give it to Lorenzo personally so we can have a better number of the ones that we are having pre-ordered. They'll come in beforehand and then we can walk around and advertise our 40th. There's also a whole bunch of other announcements in here, so please read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them. If you have not been confirmed, and you would like to be confirmed, because the bishop is coming on the 28th. Bishop is coming to St. Luke's, the only church in this part of the planet that he's going to be visiting. Normally he visits like five. He's only coming here, which is a good thing, and he's only going to have one confirmation class for this part of the state. And he's going to have it here, one confirmation service, 3 o'clock on that Saturday. Okay, so if you want to hang.
September 28th?
September 28th. It's a Saturday. One special service. He asked for it, and we said, yes, sir. 3 o'clock. Okay, but if you want confirmation classes, go over some things that the bishop is likely to want to go over. It is going to be on Saturday the 14th at 10:30 a.m. here at St. Luke's. Okay? So if you haven't been confirmed, let's show up. We'll have a conversation. We will have brunch. We will feed you. We'll make it worth your while. As I've said before, I'm here not to make many, I'm here to increase the kingdom of God in any way, shape, or can. If we can add to the congregation, that's a bonus. And when Bishop comes and confirms folks, he really likes us. So we're going to have a party on that date.
So all of the other churches on that Saturday that he's going to be here, they're coming here to have the service.
For the confirmation.
For the confirmation. So like people from El Paso are coming, Deming's coming.
If anybody,
wow,
anybody,
that's kind of cool that we're chosen.
If anybody else is having one, if members of any other church want to be confirmed during this visit, they have to come here. Now, that does not mean that all of the other church services are going to be coming here. That's just the people who want to be confirmed will be coming here.
That's kind of cool.
Oh, it's exceedingly cool, right? It's very cool that he has chosen us. He likes us, right? But what's not to like? Come on. We're a fun group. Not only that, but he can park his RV in the back lot. We've got an RV hookup for him. Not only for electricity, but it's a dump site too, so he really likes us. Birthdays and anniversaries? Any items of noteworthiness? Any of the longtime members, do y'all remember Cindy Gore? That name sound familiar to any of y'all? Cindy and Lynn Gore came on Saturday night for a long time. I only bring this up because I wanted to let you know that Cindy is in transition from this world to the next. So if you knew Cindy and you know the Gores, keep them in your prayers. Went over to do prayers for them. Can't tell, haven't seen the expiration date, but I would say that she's in the room where the door is that leads. So that's where she is in that process. I don't know. May you?
As y'all can see on the bulletin, we're not even close to our goal for the matching fund. So remember to always give beyond and your tithing, for your tithing. The briskets that we've been receiving, some from the community service people that have, in lieu of ours, are donating brisket. And our goal is 300, we're at 100 right now.
Yay.
So that's good. We still need donations, a brisket, dog toys, prizes, and all that, as you can see on your bulletin. Our tent was sponsored by Baker Glass. Thank you, Baker Glass. We're still looking for a sponsor for the t-shirts. The band, Ace and Friends, has been sponsored, but only at $400, so we still need to look for a sponsor of $100. Let's see, what else do I see here? I won't be here for the confirmation class. I'll be in school.
Yay!
Please pray for me.
Pray for the t-shirts.
I'm really excited and the journey. watching Father Daniel with his sermons. I'm learning a lot from him, but I'm also going to learn from other churches on how they worship and how they deliver their sermons. So pretty soon you will not be seeing me here on Sundays. I'll be visiting other churches, just to let you know. But I'm always a phone call away. Whenever you need me, call me, text me. I'll be happy to answer your questions.
Except on Mondays.
Mondays, I turn everything off. But I get back to you the next day. Okay, so thank you so much for all your support. Thank you, thank you, thank you. You all are such a blessing to this church.
Anything else for the good of the congregation? Because we are a concise group today, we will be having supper around the table. So that means that when comes time for communion, grab your prayer books, come on up. For those of you who can't stand for an extended period of time, we've got a number of chairs, including the bishop's chair, where Richard sat last night. Richard and his wife came to the Saturday service, and he sat in the bishop's chair. And we were like, oh, we're in trouble now. So when you come up, bring your prayer books, and we'll be fed around the table. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Can I get somebody to
push your buttons?
If you haven't signed a thank you card, it's right there also.
Deep. For the van.
Oh,
God,